We've all joined for the fourth session of the Symbiosis Golden Jubilee Lecture Series hosted by the Symbiosis International University. The Golden Jubilee Lecture Series is a brainchild of our Pro-Chancellor Dr. Vidya Iravadekar, which seeks to get eminent personalities from different walks of life to come and ignite the young minds of students at our university and to interact also with the faculty. Dr. Kiran Mazumdar Shaw is the fourth speaker in succession after Dr. Marshelkar sir, Javed Bhai Akhtar, and Mr. Satyarthi. It's my absolute delight, pleasure, and privilege to have on board Dr. Kiran Mazumdar Shaw. But before I invite Dr. Vidya to share the platform and give her formal inaugural address, I must thank Dr. Kiran Mazumdar Shaw to have made it possible to participate in this webinar despite the fact that she tested positive for COVID, which she herself admitted. And as a healthcare professional, Kiran, I really appreciate this, that you have taken the time out and have stuck to your commitment and promise which you made to Vidya a couple of weeks back. And in this pandemic, where mental health is more important and gaining far more important repercussions on health as a healthcare professional, I find this commitment, your medical condition notwithstanding, and I believe it's mild as per your tweet, it's great to have you igniting and inspiring young minds. My second comment is that as a Punekar, I was delighted to read, but I was soon let down and disappointed. My delight turned into a disappointment when initially I read on the Wikipedia that you are born in Pune, but none other than your mother, Mrs. Yamini, said, no, she is not born in Pune. That's an Yamini's commitment. She is very much a Bangalorean even by birth.
She should have been born in Pune.
Yes. So there was one Punekar going down, you know, in disappointment. But then I did realize that not only do you have a Pune connect through Mr. Pramod Chaudhary from Praj, but you have also visited Symbiosis at a Bengaluru campus on the 16th of June 2010.
And the Pune campus.
Yeah.
Yes. And finally, I would, on a parting note in this inaugural part, I just said that Dr. Vidya idolizes two Kirans in her life, and no political commitment or pun intended. She has two Didis whom she idolizes. One is Dr. Kiran Bedi, and the second one is Dr. Kiran Mazumdar Shaw. So welcome, Dr. Kiran. And I now pass on the podium to Dr. Vidya Yeravdekar, Pro-Chancellor of the University, to give her inaugural address. Dr. Vidya, please.
Thank you, Rajiv. Dr. Mazumdar sir, our Chancellor. Kiran Didi, as I fondly call you, Kiranji. Our Vice Chancellor, Dr. Rajni Gupte, and several students, faculty members, and a lot of other than Symbiosis audience that is on this platform, on the Zoom platform, and more on the YouTube live. I think Rajiv has said it all. I was supposed to say this, that, you know, of course, the reason for inviting Kiran Didi, you here, is that you are an inspiring force, not just to women like us, but really to all the youngsters who dream of becoming an entrepreneur someday like you. But for me, you are an idol. I mean, I always say this to Rajiv, that beyond my father, there are two women who I idolize with. One of them is you, and the other is, of course, Kiran Bedi. I call her Kiran Didi as well. And I think it's all about the grit and the determination and the conviction in your own self, you know, of what you have done and how you directly and indirectly inspire so many of us. When we read about you, I think I know everything about you because I've read so much about you. And, you know, it just keeps encouraging us to do more and more. And I think to those several women in our country who need it, you know, such inspiring ladies actually are very few. But then, yes, you do play an important role, even to those, you know, aspirant young women who want to do something in their lives and who want to prove themselves. So it's great to have you here on the Symbiosis platform. And we are celebrating our Golden Jubilee. You know, Dr. Mazumdar established Symbiosis in 1971. And you know, we thought, what better can we do to our students who have joined us this year, unfortunately, virtually and not physically, but at least we can do some virtual interactions of people like you. And almost every month we have at least two such interactions, you know, which helps them build their personality. And, you know, obviously they get inspired by your talks. So I don't want to take much time and I want to keenly listen to you. But I must say that when I read the news in the morning, and I follow you, so I read it when you tweeted, and my heart sunk. My heart sunk not because thinking that you may not come here, but my heart just sunk that someone so close to me that I consider as my elder sister is, you know, but your determination, I mean, you cannot believe, and what Rajiv said is right. I think today, your participation today means a lot to these thousands of students who now know that, you know, anything like this can happen to anybody, but it's your, you know, it's your determination that will keep you going. And I, as a medical doctor, have given several talks apart from my education, say, you know, webinars that COVID is all about just one more flu and nothing more. So don't read the negatives and, you know, be positive. And I'm sure you are one great example of this. So welcome to you again once more to this webinar. And I'm sure our students are going to enjoy thoroughly. Thank you, Rajiv.
For setting the ball rolling, I now have the privilege of inviting Dr. S.B. Muzumdar, sir, president and chancellor of the Symbiosis International University, himself an academician, a visionary, and a Padma awardee, to address the audience and introduce Dr. Kiran Mazumdar Shaw's talk. Dr. Mazumdar, sir, please.
Namaste, Dr. Kiran ji. Namaste, namaste.
Namaste, namaste.
Thank you. Today's distinguished speaker, Dr. Kiran Mazumdar Shaw, Dr. Vidya, Dr. Rajini Gupte, Dr. Rajiv Urdekar, and my dear students who must be hearing to all of us from different parts of our country. Kiranji, it was in 1971 that Symbiosis was started primarily for the welfare of international students studying in different colleges and institutions in Pune. And to begin with, it was a small organization. In fact, Symbiosis, Dr. Kiran Mazumdar, it was an idea. Idea to bring foreign and Indian students together. Idea to bring international understanding between foreign and Indian students. And therefore, a small organization, which I named as Symbiosis, and you know better than anybody what Symbiosis means, was started in 71. I have a great sense of fulfillment and satisfaction that this small sapling, which was born on the campus of Ferguson College way back in 1971, has now become a huge banyan tree with so many branches spread across the country. And so this idea called Symbiosis is celebrating its golden jubilee year. Unfortunately, because of COVID, we could not do many physical activities which we wanted to do. But in a way, there is something like boon in disguise. And that is, because of Corona, we could organize a distinguished lecture series by distinguished personalities like you, so that you can motivate, you can inspire, you can ignite the minds of so many students spread across the country. And therefore, it is very opportune that you should address our students today. You have really selected a very good topic, crisis, opportunity in crisis. Kiranji, I have gone through many crises in my life. Symbiosis has gone through many ups and downs. Symbiosis had to face many difficulties and problems. Sometimes the problems and difficulties appear to be insurmountable. But it is the will, it is the spirit that resides in the tough mind of human beings that ultimately triumphed, and therefore Symbiosis is what it is today. I often tell my students that tough times don't last, but tough men and women do last. And I'm really happy that one tough woman who is here with us to inspire our students. Thank you so much, Kiranji, for coming over here in spite of your health problem. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. You really summed it up. Dr. Kiran epitomizes women and tough women for that. And we at Symbiosis are privileged and witness and testimony to women empowerment with the Pro Chancellor and the Vice Chancellor and the Dean Academics and Admin and so many ladies in leadership position. And we have no complaints as men. It's my privilege to introduce Dr. Kiran Mazumdar Shaw. I'll be showing two videos at the end of reading out the CV, which looks more exhaustive than it actually is. Kiran Mazumdar Shaw is a pioneering biotech entrepreneur, a healthcare visionary, a global influencer, and a passionate philanthropist. As founder of Biocon, an innovation-led biopharmaceutical enterprise, she has been pivotal in redefining the biotechnology landscape in the country and breaking new grounds with the philosophy of ensuring affordable access to life-saving biopharmaceuticals globally. She completed her school education in Bangalore at the Bishop Kotni Girls High School and later on at the Mount Carmel College before she went on to achieve her master's from the Bangalore University. She then went on for a degree in malting and brewing from Ballard College, Melbourne, where she was awarded the gold medal. She has been awarded with several honorary degrees from universities of repute globally. It's not surprising, therefore, that she holds key positions in various industry, educational, government, and professional bodies globally. She has been elected as a full-term member of the Board of Trustees of the Massachusetts Institute of Technology, USA. In 2019, she was elected as a member of the prestigious US-based National Academy of Engineering. She also serves on the board of prestigious Indian companies like Infosys and Narayana Health. Her inspiring achievements have earned her several coveted titles, honors, and awards, both national and international. The list is exhaustive, but I'll just name a few. She is the proud recipient of two of India's highest civilian honors, the Padma Shri in 1989 and Padma Bhushan in 2005. She is also honored with the Order of Australia, Australia's highest civilian honor, in January 2020. In 2016, she was conferred with the highest French distinction, Knight of the Legion of Honor. In 2019, she was also ranked number 65 on the Forbes list of world's 100 most powerful women. Her particular focus on research and affordable innovation has helped her support many science-based startups. And Biocon has filed at least 950 patient applications based on its research activity in the recent past. In testimony to her entrepreneurial journey of over four decades, Kiran Mazumdar Shaw has been recently named as the winner of the EY World Entrepreneur Award 2020. She has been ranked as one of the world's top 20 inspirational leaders in the field of biopharmaceuticals by the Medicine Maker Power List 2020. She has also been felicitated with Advancing Women in Science and Medicine Award for Excellence in 2017 by the Feinstein Institute for Medical Research, USA. She believes in compassionate capitalism rather than philanthropy, which she says may not be sustainable, and is the first woman business leader from India to sign the Giving Pledge, an initiative of the Gates Foundation, committing to give the majority of wealth to philanthropy. In 2004, Mazumdar Shaw started a corporate social wing at Biocon, the Biocon Foundation. It's a sheer delight, an absolute privilege, madam, to have you on the session today to talk to these young students and ignite their minds and share your journey of Biocon from Bangalore to Baroda to Cork Island to Melbourne and back to Bangalore. before you started your journey in a humble 1,000 square feet garage in the backyard of your rented house with the support of your parents. You've come a long way, madam. And today, from enzymes to biopharmaceuticals to biosimilars, biologics, autoimmune drugs, and recently Syngene, it's indeed been a saga of courage, determination, grit, all of which you testify and epitomize. But before we have your session, I've got two surprises for you, as I mentioned, of your connection with Pune. And before that, Mrs. Yamini Mazumdar, the mother whom you idolize and have quoted to be the source of your entrepreneurial initiative. Can we have the videos, please?
Yamini Mazumdar, Kiran Mazumdar's mother. I'm 89 and I'm running a laundry and keep myself busy. Parents' duty is up to the time they have finished their education. After that, they fend for themselves. From childhood, Kiran has been very hardworking student, continues to do so, and she's very family oriented, cares for the family, and I'm very, very proud of her looking after the entire clan and continues to do so. I'm very proud of her. Thank you.
That was Mummy, as is affectionately and fondly known and referred to by all of Kiran's associates. And she's 89 years old and a strength of pillar to Kiran even today. And she runs her own laundry business and is fiercely an independent woman. So thank you, Mrs. Yamini, for agreeing. And I just spoke to her about a couple of years back, and tech savvy that she is, she WhatsApped me her message within 10 minutes of my telecom. So really thankful to you, Mummy. The next video is of your Pune connect way back in the early 70s. Mr. Pramod Chaudhary from Praj Industries. Pramod.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. My acquaintance and connect with Kiran Mazumdar Shaw goes back to mid 80s, when both of us received venture capital assistance from ICICI. Along the line, our both business lines ran parallel for some time. She was making the microorganisms useful for us to develop the processes. But somewhere along the line, she changed the track and she pursued her bigger vision to go in the arena of biopharma and healthcare developmental work. Her vision really saw her growing very fast, taking major strides, and today Biocon is a name in the global biotech industry. I'm happy that Kiran is coming to Pune today and coming through, of course, through the virtual route. And I'm sure that her talk, her knowledge, her experiences are going to be very, very interesting and important for the new generation to learn a lot out of her experience and achievements. I wish her good luck, and also to all of you. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Pramod. All yours, Kiran. The stage is set. And the least I can say is the last count I got of people joining the webinar is 1,248. And they are growing by the minute. All yours.
Thank you, Rajiv. Thank you, Dr. Mazumdar. Thank you, Vidya. Thank you, Pramod. Of course, thanks to my dear mom. And of course, thank you to all the viewers of this webinar, the dear students of Symbiosis International University. I want to start by congratulating you on your golden jubilee. I think this is a great honor for me to talk to all of you on this occasion. As you very well know, I tweeted that I tested positive last night. And I know that there were some anxious moments at the end of Symbiosis because I think they were worried whether I would be able to, you know, do this webinar or not. But I feel that this was an opportunity for me to tell all of you that whatever the challenge, I don't think you should be fearful of such challenges. And the reason I actually, decided to talk about converting a crisis into an opportunity was because I believe that when you face a crisis, when you face a challenge, you come out with so much learning and you come out with so much, understanding of what it takes to overcome a challenge that you come out stronger. My whole life's journey has been about facing crises, about facing challenges, and about overcoming these challenges and crises to come out much stronger, much more informed, and learn so much from those challenges. So I just thought that I would use this to really, reach out to young people, young students, to say, listen, this is a crisis, but I'm very confident that this crisis will make all of us stronger, will make our country stronger, will make us as scientists, as engineers, as entrepreneurs, much stronger and more determined than ever. So let us look at two big outcomes that we've seen out of this crisis already. The first is Atmanirbhar Bharat, and the second is the National Digital Health Mission. Why do I say that these are two big outcomes of COVID? Because we would have never really seen the spotlight on healthcare and the spotlight on self-reliance had it not been for COVID. So let's look at the positives of the crisis. Let me start with my own life's journey. I started my business, my company, my entrepreneurial journey in 1978 because I faced a big challenge, a big crisis in my life. I had come back from Australia with a great degree in brewing and malting science, thinking that I was going to be absolutely, grabbed by the brewing industry in India because I was so accomplished, so, qualified to take on a leadership role in brewing. But then I got a rude shock when the brewing industry in India said, this is not a space for women. This is not a job for women. And that basically allowed me to think about what could I do next if I couldn't pursue a job in brewing. And that's when an accidental encounter with a biotech entrepreneur from Ireland saw me start a biotech company in India. So I always say that Biocon India was born because of a gender bias. And that is what I did. I created an opportunity out of a crisis. I would have never thought of myself as an entrepreneur. I never dreamt of starting my own business. All I wanted was to pursue a professional career in brewing. But then a crisis changed my life and I started my own company. Of course, I pioneered the biotech sector in India. Nobody wanted to even invest in biotechnology. Nobody understood what biotechnology was. And every time I went to a bank to ask for a credit line, they would say, what the hell is biotech? And you're too young to start an industry. And you don't have any business experience. What the hell are you trying to do to take such a risky path? But I didn't give up. I felt that this was a unique opportunity for me to start something so exciting as a biotech company, because at that point in time, I started my company developing enzyme technologies. And I was so excited with the thought of replacing polluting chemical technologies with eco-friendly biotechnologies like enzyme technologies, that's what got me started. I always tell young people, please have a a spirit of challenge and a sense of purpose. This was my driving sense of purpose, that I could clean up the world. I could really sort of stop pollution and stop polluting the world. And that was what was my driving sense of purpose. And for 20 years, I did that. I developed a large number of biotechnologies and enzyme technologies, which even Pramod spoke about. I was developing enzymes for even converting various forms of starch into ethanol. And that's what then Pramod has done very well to get into this whole area of biofuels. He has now created very, very sophisticated technologies to produce ethanol and biofuels. So I think that's what I was involved with in the early days, developing enzymes for these bioconversions. But then somewhere along the line, I felt that there was an even bigger and more exciting opportunity in biopharmaceuticals, where I felt that the world was being challenged by access to, you know, very important, essential, life-saving biopharmaceuticals, which were beyond the reach of most people because they were so expensive. So I felt that being in India, I ought to provide affordable access to these kind of products. And that's where my journey began in biopharmaceuticals. I started with insulins, and I started then with antibodies for cancer and autoimmune diseases. And that journey has been a very exciting journey, because I think my whole focus was on global healthcare, impacting global healthcare through affordable access. And that has been such an important sense of purpose for me. And today we are very proud that we are the lowest cost producers of insulins. We are one of the largest producers of insulins, along with three other global companies. And we are also now spearing ahead in terms of developing biosimilars. And we are the only biosimilar company from India that has taken our biosimilars global to the US, European, and other advanced economies that never thought it was possible for a company out of India to make such high quality products. What have I believed in? I believed in our talent base. I think India has a terrific talent pool of scientists and engineers whom I've leveraged. I've also believed a lot in the capabilities and the can-do attitude that India has to be globally competitive. I've of course leveraged our competitive cost structure in India to be globally competitive. And of course, I've invested a lot in making sure that we are world-class. World-class in our quality systems, our manufacturing systems, and all the governance systems that we have to put in place to play in the global arena. So that is what has made it possible for me to convert many, many crises or challenges into opportunities. And I look at COVID as yet another such example, because I believe that COVID has taught us that India needs to focus on innovation. You know, I have made these statements quite a lot recently, saying that although India accounts for the largest capacity in vaccine production, the largest capacity in manufacturing generic medicines for the world, yet we only account for 3% of the global value chain in pharmaceuticals. And why is that? Because 90% of the global value chain in pharmaceuticals is accounted for by innovative drugs and vaccines. Only 10% is accounted for by generic medicines and vaccines. And I, for one, believe that this has to change. India has the capabilities to actually carve out a much bigger share of the global value chain. And that will only happen if we innovate. And today, COVID has shown us that there is an opportunity for Indian companies to innovate. Our own company basically had invested in a very novel drug, which was a first-in-class drug, which was an immunomodulatory drug, which we developed. We had licensed it from a Cuban laboratory 20 years ago. We developed it in India and developed it for psoriasis, which was approved in 2013. And ever since then, we had basically only looked at the autoimmune component of this disease, but we also licensed this drug to a US company saying, this is an excellent, unique drug. See what you can do to develop it for the US, because that's where the credibility is. India, unfortunately, does not believe in its own capabilities and its own innovative strengths. So I just felt that if you have to develop credibility for such important drugs, it's better done in a country like the US, which has a huge credibility in innovation. And if they endorse such a product, then India benefits from that endorsement. That was the way I looked at this drug. And then COVID came along, and I realized that one of the biggest challenges that COVID imposes is the cytokine storm that the virus creates. And that is what was actually making it life-threatening for patients who contract COVID. And therefore, I felt that this was a drug that I could actually repurpose to address that cytokine storm, because that is the way the body fights autoimmune diseases. And I felt this was a very good way of using this drug. And we did a small trial wherein we did a proof of concept to see, does it work? And it does work. And that, realization and recognition that it works was a huge eureka moment for us, because even our US partners have decided to to conduct an even bigger global trial with the drug. In India, already thousands of patients have benefited from the use of this drug. I believe we have saved so many lives because of this drug. And we will continue now to make it into a big, big opportunity from India. I really believe this is a drug that goes beyond COVID, because the cytokine release syndrome is encountered in many, many conditions. In fact, our US partners were actually doing a trial in graft versus host disease, which is the body's, the challenge of accepting a transplant. And this happens in many, many cases, whether it's a bone marrow transplant, whether it's a kidney transplant, a liver transplant, or any organ transplant, the body rejects the graft, as it is called. And by using this drug, we are able to see that the body's immune system or the immune response can be calmed down, and the graft gets accepted by the host, which is the transplant recipient. Now, the first data that has come out of Dana-Farber in Boston is very encouraging with our drug. And we believe that this can be a huge opportunity beyond COVID for this drug. So you can see how a crisis like COVID has actually opened the doors for us in a very unexpected way for this drug. And therefore, I believe that for India, the recognition and realization that we don't have enough diagnostic tests, that we don't have enough PPEs, that we don't have enough ventilators, that we don't have enough hospital beds, or how do we plan and monitor this disease, has opened up so many opportunities. Today, we've become one of the largest producers of PPEs in the world. We have become also very, very large producers of ventilators, and sophisticated ventilators at that. We have come up with so many different types of kits. We are now self-reliant in RT-PCR kit manufacture, and therefore we've been able to ramp up our capacity of testing so enormously. We've also seen that companies like ours have repurposed drugs, and we've come up with uniquely new drugs. And now we're even coming up with our own vaccines in the country. So you can see, and then our own vaccine manufacturers, including Pune's own Serum Institute, is partnering with so many vaccine companies to make sure that the capacity that the world needs is being addressed. And Indian companies are doing all of this. So I think it must make us very proud that Atmanirbhar Bharat has suddenly opened our eyes to the fact that we actually have such big strengths and such big capabilities to make ourselves not just... And when you talk about self-reliance, it is about being globally competitive and being part of a global value chain and a global supply chain. That's what Atmanirbhar is. That is not just about inward looking and making sure that you can have everything on your own, but it's about Atmanirbhar in a way that's sustainable, that It shows that you can be a part of a global need, a global opportunity, and yet be serving your own needs. I think that to me is Atmanirbhar. And then you come to the next one, which is the National Digital Health Mission, which is so important. And all this has come because we realize that every country's healthcare system is broken, including India's. We saw that, how weak our healthcare system was. We got overwhelmed with patients very, very fast. And today we know that there is an urgent need to focus on the healthcare sector. And Ayushman Bharat has become so much more significant than it was when it was announced. But Ayushman Bharat now has to go beyond just cashless hospitalization, but to its wellness centers, because the primary healthcare is so, so very important. And using digital technologies that gives you a mobile portable health card, which can be accessed from anywhere in the country, which can have a continuum of healthcare records on that card, and which can then also help the entire healthcare ecosystem to be digitally monitored, digitally connected, is going to be so important for translational research, for mapping healthcare outcomes, for making sure that we have standard of care. You know, in India, we don't have this concept of standard of care. Even in COVID, you go to hospital A, they treat COVID one way. You go to hospital B, it treats COVID another way. Even though there is a national protocol for COVID management, it's never followed anywhere because everyone is looking at it in a trial and error method. Oh, this worked well for me here. I'm going to use this. So I think even the national protocol is kind of evolving as we speak, because we need to understand data. We need to, analyze that data very fast. We have to do it real time. All this is only possible with digital technologies. And I'm very confident that what we've learned from this pandemic is that we've not been in a very good state of preparedness. We have not planned the management very well. And one thing this has also taught us is we need to use science. We need to, use a risk-driven decision-making. So what is the risk of doing this or not doing this? That is the way you have to take decision-making. You have to decide. We've all heard about the warp speed regulatory pathway for developing vaccines. But the question is, even if it is warp speed, what is the basic science-led decision-making that we must not compromise on? And I think one of the big questions today that is being asked is, should we not at least have durability of response as one such important scientific criteria? Or are you just going to approve a vaccine based on the immune response of patients? And we know that immune response in many cases doesn't stay for too long. So those are the kind of questions people are asking today, saying, what should be the minimum regulatory path? Because that's another big opportunity that this crisis has actually thrown to the world, saying that in the past, we have spent so many years developing a vaccine or a drug or a device or any pharmaceutical product. Is this the time for us to now use very high science and good, risk-based decision-making to make sure that we can compress these timelines? And what should be that compressed timeline? How should it look? Those are the kind of questions we have to ask. So I think this is many crises throw up many opportunities. We should not lose this opportunity. And I think the world is going to look at this and come out much stronger, because it is going to invest a lot more in healthcare. It is going to strengthen its primary health system. It is going to make sure that we use digital data in a much more predictive and proactive way. And more than anything else, I think the focus has come back on infectious diseases. Infectious diseases were always considered to be diseases of the developing world, and the developed world never bothered about it. They didn't even want to invest in research in infectious diseases. Today, again, everybody is now focusing on vaccines and infectious diseases. I think because the world realizes we are an interconnected world. We cannot lose sight of that. Secondly, I think what we have also seen is that every part of the world realizes that there has to be collaboration. Even today, the question being asked is there going to be nationalism in terms of distributing vaccines? Are the developed countries going to gobble up and buy up all the vaccines? I think the answer is no, because fortunately, India has a huge say in vaccine production and vaccine distribution. So I'm glad that we can actually play a very good role for global distribution of vaccines. And I think we all need to understand that greed is not going to get us anywhere. This pandemic has also showed us the huge impact of the lockdown on environmental cleanup. And it shows that just a few months of not polluting our environment actually cleaned up the environment. So it actually tells us that we have to think about cleaning up our environment and making sure that we get it back into a clean state, which unfortunately has been polluted by us for so long. But you can see that just a few months and nature was cleaned up. So it gives us hope to know that coming out with better environmental policies can actually correct that big wrong that we have done, and so on and so forth. And of course, out of this crisis has also come the digital virtual world, which has opened up a huge number of tech opportunities to a number of tech startups, whether it is apps for contact tracing, whether it's apps for, you know, giving you information on how to manage, COVID, or how do you kind of treat yourself if you're COVID positive, or exchanging news about COVID between different patients who have been struck with the disease. You know, everything is now opening up. So I don't think young people should feel scared or feel that, oh, we've lost our jobs, because it is creating new job opportunities. It is creating new jobs. And I think all of you must look at it with a sense of challenge and an opportunity to do things differently. Look at the way we're having this webinar. I don't think in the old world we would have done this, because we would have all wanted to have a physical event where I would have had to come across to Pune, and then the calendars wouldn't match, and then all kinds of things would have happened, and I couldn't have spoken to all of you in this kind of way. So let's look at the positives. I always believe that every such calamity and crisis throws up opportunities, and you should always remain positive. So I think with those few words, I would like to now open it up for question and answers. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. It was indeed a very fascinating, a very insightful, and a very informative lecture. I'm Dr. Anuradha Vaidya, and I represent the School of Symbiosis School of Biological Sciences, Symbiosis International University. And I would really like to thank our Dean, sir, Dr. Rajiv, sir, who is the Dean of Faculty of Health Sciences, for providing me with this very privileged opportunity to coordinate the question answer session for this particular lecture. So ma'am, once again, thank you so much for this insightful lecture and for helping us see look at this situation, which is taken as a grim situation by so many people, and to help us look at it in such a positive way. So with this, I would like to now take up the first question. Ms. Sai Zamre, could you please unmute yourself and ask ma'am the first question?
Good afternoon, madam. My name is Sai Zamre. I am a second year MSc Biotechnology student from Symbiosis School of Biological Sciences. My question for you is, being a first generation entrepreneur, it must have been undoubtedly a tough journey. Looking back, what is that one piece of advice you wish you had been given when you were starting Biocon? Madam, your views, please.
I don't think I needed any advice. I think you have to believe in yourself. You have to be driven by a sense of purpose. And I don't think I sought advice from anybody. I just felt that I had to do it. I was determined to do something, because I had been disappointed in being turned away by industry. And therefore, I just created my own company. So I don't think And I would say this to all you young people. Don't keep looking to others to tell you what to do. You should be quite clear about what you want to do in life. If you're clear about a purpose in life and doing something valuable and useful in life, I don't think you will need any advice.
Okay, thank you, ma'am. We can have the next question now. Dr. Rupashree, could you please unmute yourself? Dr. Rupashree?
Yes.
Yeah.
Good afternoon, madam. I'm Dr. Rupashree. I am Rangayan. I'm working as professor in MBA Hospital and Healthcare Management from Symbiosis Institute of Health Sciences. My question is, what according to you are the challenges of Indian biotechnology industry is facing? Are we ready for with a befitting replay for the biotechnology sector as regards to post-COVID-19 readiness? Madam, your views, please. Thank you.
So to me, I think we've always had a challenge of accessing capital for a biotech company. See, biotech companies require a lot of capital investment. And I think whilst the government has played a very important role in providing that early risk capital, we have not seen venture funds provide the next phase of capital because they feel that the biotech sector is high risk and gestational, which means it takes a long time to take a product from lab to market. And that is why I think we really need to ensure that access to capital is something that is done in a big way. I remember when I started my company, there was no question of venture capital. I used to go and borrow money. So today, I think even if venture capital is not available, banks should prioritize lending to biotech companies who want to scale up or go to the next level until the venture funds come in. So I think this is something which maybe the government should look at saying, can we ask banks to kind of create a section for venture funding for the biotech sector? That is something which I think might help the sector in a big way, because I know how difficult it was for even me to access capital when I needed it most. And it was thanks to a new venture fund arm that was formed at ICICI that I was able to avail of that funding.
Thank you, ma'am. And I think if that happens, it will be a good stepping stone for a lot of young entrepreneurs. With that, we can take the next question. Mr. Nag, Debran Nag, are you online? Could you please ask the next question, please? Please unmute yourself. Mr. Debran?
Good afternoon, ma'am.
Yes.
Yes, ma'am. Good afternoon, ma'am. I'm Debran Nag. I'm currently pursuing in third semester from Symbiosis Institute of Management Studies, Pune. Ma'am, my question is, India is expected to launch a vaccine for COVID-19 by end of 2020 or by early 2021. If Biocon comes up with a COVID-19 vaccine, how do you think Biocon is going to address the supply chain pressure for the vaccine?
So first and foremost, I want to clarify that Biocon is not developing a vaccine. We are only supporting vaccine companies with various biotech services, okay, from our company Syngene. But if you think about what is happening in India, we are very fortunate that we have multiple companies all developing vaccines of their own or partnering with overseas companies to develop vaccines. So for instance, you have got a Serum Institute that has partnered with Oxford University, and then you've got in Hyderabad you've got Bharat Biotech developing a vaccine along with ICMR. You've got in Ahmedabad Zydus Cadila developing a vaccine it's their own vaccine. And then you've got Biologically that has recently announced a partnership with J&J to develop their vaccines. Now, I'm sure that by the end of the year, you might get an emergency use authorization for a few vaccines around the world, but the real approvals for vaccines will not come before March next year, I personally believe, because you do need durability of response before you give a full approval. So even assuming that you get approvals in early part of next year, I think you need to do a preparedness planning in terms of who are the people you will actually first vaccinate. And according to me, the people who should be first vaccinated are the healthcare workers and the working class youth who go to work every day. So I think what you have to understand is that these are the kind of measures you need to take. And from that point of view, the logistics should be worked out right now so that you can plan that way. I think the people who should, the vulnerable, population, such if you look at the vulnerable population like the elderly or those with comorbidities or children for that matter, they need to actually not be exposed to the vaccine till you absolutely get the efficacy, safety, and the durability data. And that would therefore happen later on in the year. Even though there's a lot of thinking that says that, oh, maybe the vulnerable should be vaccinated first. I am not in favor of that because remember, most of the trials have been done in young, healthy volunteers. And therefore, I am very reluctant to expose the elderly or the children or the people with comorbidities to the vaccine before you get all the data. So if you get an early emergency use kind of approval, I would do it with these kind of people in the population, the healthcare workers and the, as I said, the working class, the young working class, the youth.
Thank you, ma'am. Again, once it's a very important point that actually the healthcare workers and the working youth should actually be given the first trials of vaccine and not the people who are having comorbid situations or, like you said, the vulnerable groups.
Yeah, and I just want to add there, because the moment you protect the young, you almost automatically protect the elderly, because they are the ones who have to, who come in contact with them.
Absolutely.
I mean, today, let me tell you, I got my COVID vaccine from young asymptomatic carriers.
Yes. Yes, ma'am. That's absolutely right. Thank you so much for answering this question. We'll have the next question very quickly. Mr. Arman, are you online? Could you please unmute yourself and ask the next question to ma'am?
Good afternoon, ma'am. My name is Arman. I'm from Symbiosis Institute of International Business, Pune. I'm pursuing MBA Agribusiness. And my question for you is, a few weeks back, you had mentioned that India needs to draw up an immunization strategy for COVID-19, where the Indian government has to work with pharma companies for a subsidy plan and a distribution plan. What kind of model will you suggest for this? And do you think this kind of public-private partnership will be feasible? Ma'am, your views?
Well, I certainly believe this is an opportunity for doing that, because I think the government has to start planning right now. Because we know all the kinds of vaccines that are under development, and we can start tracking to see which is going to, be approved when. And if we start planning, I think we can do a great job of it. I don't think we should wait till the end to then start, doing things in a kind of a responsive or a reactive way or a knee-jerk way. I think we should start planning to say, what if this vaccine is approved in, what happens if this vaccine is approved in November, December, January, February, March? Each vaccine, you can do it. And then if you see that at any given point in time, there are 4 or 5 vaccines available, how are you going to make the most of that? Those are the kind of planning exercises that the government should do, and the private sector must partner the government in doing such things.
Yes, planning, again, very, very important for testing all different kinds of vaccines. Completely agree. Thank you, ma'am, again for your response. Next question, Mr. Akash Tiwari, are you online? Could you please unmute yourself? Mr. Akash, could you please unmute yourself?
Good afternoon, ma'am. So myself, Akash Tiwari, MSc second year student at Symbiosis School of Biological Sciences. So my question to you, ma'am, during this current pandemic, when most of the industries are being shut and unemployment is on the rise, how do you foresee the current situation as an opportunity or a calamity for the first generation entrepreneur? Your views, ma'am. Thank you.
I think I mentioned it in my talk that I always think that an opportunity, a crisis always throws up opportunities. And I think young people should look at what is this new opportunity for them. For instance, you know that today, because of the containment, because of social distancing, because of the fact that many enterprises are not open, how do you then create new opportunities, new business opportunities, new jobs? How do you do all that? For instance, I know that many restaurants today are doing a lot of home delivery services, right? And they're also coming up with new products, new kind of campaigns. They're saying, okay, listen, if you want to have a little party at home, we will actually provide you and cater this whole party at your house. You know, these are the kind of new things that are happening. Even I know that many of the beverage companies are saying, let's give you a party pack. Why don't you have a party and we will, organize this for you in a nice way. So, you know, so many new ideas are coming out. Then secondly, we are looking at, as I said, contact tracing. How do you create apps for contact tracing? How do you then, create many other things, like somebody wants to know where there is a hospital bed. So there's an app now which governments have developed saying, we will tell you where there is a free hospital bed. Or if you want to know where is your nearest testing center, those kind of apps are also coming out. Then a lot of people want to know what are the good ways of managing COVID if you get it. You know, so that kind of apps are also coming out. So, you know, there are a lot of new opportunities for doing this. Now there's data analytics is becoming a huge opportunity in healthcare. Now, as I mentioned, this whole digital healthcare itself is going to create a large number of job opportunities. So all of you tech savvy kids, you must take up these kind of new opportunities in the digital health mission. You know, none of our hospitals have got electronic medical records. Can you create a software that can actually very quickly create electronic medical records for hospitals, small nursing homes, and make it in a way that is cost effective, that also can be very seamlessly integrated into a bigger master database, things like that. So I think there's a lot of opportunities for you people. Then the government has also given young people that opportunity of creating your own Deshi TikTok or some of those other apps. You know, you look around the world, how many young innovative startups have started with just some very innovative ideas. Let your imagination run wild. Okay?
Yes, ma'am. Yes, that's in fact, indeed a very good advice to all the youngsters who are listening to us right now, that please take this situation as an opportunity and you can start, you can have so many ideas, just put those ideas into use. We'll take a last two questions only because we don't have much time left. So could I have Mr. Bobby Paul online? Are you online, Bobby? Could you please unmute yourself?
Yes. Yeah. So good afternoon, ma'am. I'm Bobby Paul. I'm pursuing my MBA from Symbiosis Institute of International Business, and I'm specializing in energy and environment. So ma'am, recently, Mr. Donald Trump signed an executive order requiring the government to purchase locally made essential medicines and medical supplies. So would this affect Indian pharmaceutical industry, which has outshined other industries amidst the COVID-19 crisis? So ma'am, can you share your views on this?
I think, Donald Trump's response was against the over-reliance on China. And I think, of course, it does impact, if it is taken to an extreme, obviously it does impact even Indian companies. But let me be very honest. I think we must understand that to shift anything from one destination to another is not easy. From a regulatory compliance point of view, it takes a long time to do tech transfer from one place to another. It's not that easy. So I would imagine that it's more of a threat than a reality. I think the US also recognizes the importance of India, the importance that Indian generics and products bring to the US. As you know, that even during this crisis, India was able to have an HCQ diplomacy, if you remember. And we can even have a vaccine diplomacy if we really are smart about it with the world. So I, for one, believe that this is not something to be fearful of. I think we should focus on partnerships. I think we should focus on these bilateral trade deals, which are about partnership. Okay?
Yes. Collaborations and partnerships for the future are very important. With that, we'll go for the last question. Dr. Shraddha, are you online? Could you please unmute yourself?
Good afternoon, ma'am. This is Dr. Shraddha Yadav, Department of Pharmacology from Symbiosis Medical College for Women. My question to you, ma'am, is how can medical students be exposed to short trainings or internship in pharmaceutical or biotech industry, and what areas of knowledge and exposure should be given to medical students, which can help the future students to take up challenges of biotechnology and pharmaceutical industry? Thank you.
I think there are many, many internship programs available at every pharmaceutical, biopharmaceutical company. And I think, you know, you ought to kind of look at all these kind of internship programs. In addition to that, I think there is a need for, you know, organizations like NIPER to really focus on a biopharmaceutical specialization. And I think we're trying to do that in some parts of the country, where, you know, industry will actually conduct a lot of these programs and allow, you know, sort of site visits and give projects which are very industry specific. I think that's what is required. We ourselves have something called the Biocon Academy, and we have a partnership now with Symbiosis. And I think that's where we also want to make sure that young people understand what industry needs are and what it is to really sort of focus on industry skills. Okay.
Muzumdar sir would like to ask a question.
Sure. This is not a question, Dr. Kiran. Sometime back, I happened to read editorial in Times of India, and it had mentioned very proudly your name. And you had suggested to the government that just as government gave so many concessions to information technology, they give moratorium, they give incentives, and whatnot. Similarly, you argued that time has come now for government to take healthcare as priority area. And just as they give so many concessions to IT, they should also consider healthcare. And you also argued that healthcare will open up so many jobs, perhaps more than what IT had, and now IT is declining. So what is the response to your suggestion by government?
Well, I'm always hopeful. I'm always positive that the government will listen and do something.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Muzumdar.
Thank you so much, ma'am. Now I would request our own Vice Chancellor, Dr. Rajni Gupte, ma'am, to give the vote of thanks. Thank you so much. Gupte, ma'am, could you please unmute?
Yeah, Dr. S.B. Muzumdar, the Chancellor of the University and the founder of Symbiosis, Dr. Vidya, the Pro-Chancellor of the University, Dr. Kiran Muzumdar Shaw, our esteemed guest for the Golden Jubilee Lecture Series today, Dr. Rajiv moderating the session today, other deans, directors, faculty, staff, and students who have joined this session. Ma'am, it's truly an honor to thank you for this wonderful session. I must tell you that several years ago, when I used to head the Symbiosis Institute of International Business, I had tried rather unsuccessfully to invite you to address our students at our leadership series then. since I've always been a great admirer of your inspiring leadership. And hence, I'm so happy today that our students have an opportunity to listen to you at a time when Biocon has really reached the pinnacle of success. Turning a crisis into an opportunity is something that your very life exemplifies. Getting into a profession dominated by men and then building Biocon into a brand to reckon with has been a fabulous story. You spoke about two initiatives of the government, Atmanirbhar and National Digital Health Initiative, as the positive outcomes of the present pandemic. I think it's so very important at a time like this, when a lot of young people are under stress and feel that there's nothing positive around them, to listen to you, your positivity was indeed wonderful. A woman leader who grew from strength to strength with every challenge. You mentioned that innovation has been the key driver of your success. You spoke about translating an idea into a business opportunity and then mass scaling it for the benefit of people. You urged the students to have a sense of purpose in their lives. In our country, where we fall behind on all the parameters of health, to leave behind a legacy of giving affordable health care speaks volume of your life's missions. Your work and philanthropy, I'm sure, will continue to inspire many. We are honored by your presence today, in spite of your illness. Let me wish you a speedy recovery. And let me end by thanking my colleagues, our IT team. I also noticed that a large number of our staff have joined in today. Thank you all for joining in. I thank the students for their questions. And of course, all the other students and participants who have joined in for this session. Thank you once again. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Gupta, ma'am. Thank you, Dr. Kiran, Anuradha, for having anchored the session, question answer session, Dr. Muzumdar, sir, Dr. Vidya, and all my colleagues who have joined and made this session wonderful. And we wish Dr. Kiran a speedy recovery. And just to remind you all guys that very soon on the 30th of August, we have none other than the Maharaja of Indian cricket, Mr. Saurav Ganguly, who will be the guest speaker under the Symbiosis Golden Jubilee Lecture Series. So pad up and be ready to face the Maharaja of the Indian cricket. Good luck and all the best, Kiran Mazumdar Shaw, madam. Thank you for a wonderful session. Thank you, everyone.